Hello, B here, and welcome back to biology. Can you believe we are starting on our last unit in biology? We've spent quite a few lessons already talking about life in this biology course, starting with the chemical building blocks that make up life, the organization of life into cells, as well as different types of organisms that we find in the living world. Now it's time to tie it all together with this unit on ecology. What is ecology? If you remember those five themes of biology we talked about all the way back at the beginning of the course, ecology is theme number five, the interdependence of organisms. As we go through this unit, look for ways that organisms are depending on each other and on their physical environment. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to define biomes, population, communities, and resources. Explain how interactions between organisms shape ecosystems. Don't you just love watching animal videos? I mean, this is biology, the study of life, and animals are alive, so we can do this all day and call it a class, right? Well, sometimes we do get to watch fun animal videos in biology, but as you watch these videos, notice what's different about each one. These animals are living very different lives because they are living in very different environments. We call these different environments biomes. Some of the major biomes on Earth include rainforest, tundra, marine, desert, grassland, and temperate forest. Do you happen to know which biome you live in? And did you see examples of all of those in the videos? Let's look again. We have a monkey climbing in the rainforest, an owl catching a mouse in the tundra, yum, tropical fish in a marine biome, a camel munching on the sparse plant life in the desert, an adorable baby gazelle in the grassland, and finally, a shiny red ladybug in the temperate forest. We'll take a closer look at some of these biomes in an upcoming lesson. We said that ecology is the interdependence of organisms, both between each other and their environment. Did you see any examples of organisms depending on each other in the videos? I'll give you a hint. Sometimes the organisms are not even animals. Organism just means an individual living thing. It could be an animal, plant, fungus, or even bacteria. In almost every video, we saw animals interacting with plants, living among plants, and eating plants. And of course, one example of two animals interacting, which did not end well for the mouse. These are the kinds of interactions we study in ecology. Some of these relationships are obvious, like a koala living in a tree. Others are less obvious, like the fact that tiny microscopic creatures live in our stomachs. Are you grossed out? Don't worry. Many of these bacteria are actually helpful to us and help digest our food. This is an example of an interaction called symbiosis, where both organisms help each other out. Another example of symbiosis you might be familiar with is a clownfish living in a sea anemone. How do the organisms help each other out in that example? Any ideas? The sea anemone provides shelter and protection to the clownfish, and the clownfish provides nutrients in the form of waste to the sea anemone. Life is full of these kinds of interactions. Even pets can represent a symbiotic relationship with humans. We've looked at a lot of examples of individual organisms, but what about groups of organisms living and interacting together? A population is a group of the same kind of organism living in the same geographic area. That geographic area could be the whole Earth, or it could be smaller, like a single city or country. But populations usually coexist with other species that share their habitat. All of the living things in the same geographic area are known as the community. Another word you will hear in place of community is biocenosis. A biocenosis may contain multiple plant species, animals, and other microscopic organisms. What community of living things do you see near your home? In order for humans or any type of organism to live, eat, reproduce, and generally thrive, they need to consume resources. A resource can be anything that is needed and used, like water, sunlight, air, food, gasoline, and materials for building shelter. Many of the resources that we use on a daily basis, we don't even think about. Hopefully, you've never had to worry about your supply of oxygen running out while you're breathing. But looking at those examples, which ones do you think we might have to worry about running out of? I don't think we'll run out of sunlight anytime soon, but gasoline for our cars? Could we run out of that? Possibly so. This is because some resources take a very long time to form. We're talking millions of years. These resources are called non-renewable resources and include things like coal, oil, and natural gas. These resources are also called fossil fuels and are often used to produce electricity and fuel to power homes, cars, and factories. Resources that can be naturally replaced in a short amount of time are called renewable resources. These usually include sunlight, water, air, and even most resources that come from living things like wood and food. Based on our current supply of oil and the rate at which we are using it, some scientists think we could deplete the world's natural supply of crude oil by the end of this century. If that happens, we'll need to find a different way of powering our cars because the gasoline you buy at the pump is made from crude oil. Ideally, we would like to find other resources to get energy from anyway, because not only will these non-renewable resources run out, but they also produce a large amount of pollution as they are used. This pollution can act like a blanket on the Earth, causing it to heat up in a phenomenon known as climate change or global warming. Continuing to use non-renewable resources will accelerate climate change as more harmful pollutants are released into our atmosphere. Luckily, innovation and ingenuity have led to other renewable and recyclable forms of resources being harnessed, like nuclear, wind, and solar power, which can be used in a way that is cleaner for the environment. And we won't run out of them, so it's a win-win. If we want to take full advantage of the benefits of clean and renewable resources, we'll need to build many more of these types of power plants in the coming years. We've already looked at some of the unique types of organisms that live on Earth, but did you know that 99% of the types of organisms that have ever lived on Earth have already gone extinct? Extinct means that there are no more living members of that population left on Earth. Of course, the most famous extinct animals are the dinosaurs, and as humans, we might be just a tad bit grateful that they're gone. But there are countless other plants, animals, fungi, and microscopic organisms that we will never see with our own eyes. What about the populations that are still here on Earth, though? Could any of them go extinct too? Unfortunately, yes. Many populations are endangered. This means they are in danger of going extinct within our lifetime. One of the many applications of ecology is to find ways that humans can have a positive impact on the planet and preserve biodiversity by preventing further extinctions. As we went through the lesson today, we previewed some of the ecology topics that you will study in this unit. As always, the lesson PDFs for the whole ecology unit are attached to this lesson. It's a good idea to go ahead and download that file or print it out, but you can also find individual lesson PDFs with each lesson video as you go. Next time, we'll look at one of the most fundamental parts of ecosystems, energy, and we'll see how food webs show us the energy transfers that go on in ecosystems. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time. Hey, hey.